Well, great. How are you feeling? Do you feel okay with just kind of like diving right in and wigging it?
Absolutely. Yep.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Processing the election over the last couple of days, I felt the skill sets that you, Darrell Becker, have been encouraging the world to explore with you and have been teaching a lot to me and a lot of my peers and our fellow community members, especially in the Tragedy and Hope online community. I felt before the election that your focus on nonviolent communication and critical thinking was going to be, you know, as needed as ever, more needed than ever, no matter who was elected. You know, like the setting for this election was, boiling. You know, we're at a boiling point, and so your tool sets are so invaluable, and I wanted to just share part of my partner Katie and I, our discussions and processing. I wanted to get more minds on this conversation. So I was hoping you could start out with a little overview of the focus of your work, and I will refer people to a more thorough discussion or training podcast you've done that give more details on the whole process. But I'd love an overview for my friends who don't know your work yet.
All right. So to start with, why I go on podcasts right now as a guest is usually to cover the issues of methods that create harmony, both intellectually, and those are critical thinking skills. I heavily focus on the Trivium method of critical thinking and my own applications of that. So that's like a, I would call it like a mind kung fu method, you know, mm-hmm. some way to just internally keep things nice and solid and balanced for the purpose of balance, like that, harmony. And then emotional methods. I use largely my own interpretation of nonviolent communication, a methodology that was originated by Marshall Rosenberg. So I use a variant of that specific type of tool. And then putting them together, I found it was really harmonious. The nonviolent communication method would be ways of balancing emotions or the emotional terrain, taking 100% responsibility, the ability to respond to all the emotions going on. And then from there, more recently, been training in organization and action methods coming from David Allen, getting things done methodology. The three of them are pretty much going together into my book that I work on and related courses that will be related to, you know, going on from that. So when processing large events in the world or small ones in our personal lives, which can feel very large, I would say, it comes down to perspective. And I definitely was watching how all these things affect people, just like you guys. I look forward to finding out how what your perspectives are so far, because I'm over here on the Big Island of Hawaii, for context. So I get to see a whole lot of people who were voting for Hillary and some people who were voting for Trump. And then certainly the people who threw up their hands and said, I don't need to participate in this. And myself, where I was saying, well, I'm going to put time and effort into things that are productive. And that's, of course, you know, a puppet show, which is how I see these political shenanigans, is not something I see as productive for my time. But I do pay attention to how people are affected by things. Mm-hmm. How perception is managed is one of the classic focuses of my study, my own perceptions and other people's. And if you look up perception management with Wikipedia, you'll find out that it's a Department of Defense term, that it comes from the military, and that there's a reason for that. When you understand who might the enemy be, in this case, I would say everyone who's not part of the military, that's everyone across the world is the enemy. And then you can see that there are methods to manage perception of these people. So if you have a bunch of people divided, they're easy to conquer. This is a very, very ancient tactic. It's been going through some, I don't know, like 10,000-year-old iterations of divide and conquer at this point, at least in historical terms. Mm-hmm. So what I look to do is to offer people updates to their mental and emotional operating systems, to just give them a way to get more predicted and desired results by virtue of having a predicted way of managing your thoughts and achieving a desired result, and having a predicted way of managing one's own internal terrain emotionally. And then from there, there's a chance of making a bridge with other people, to connect with them, at least on some human type level, and getting something that you want done. So I'm here to check out what can I do to add to this discussion. I want to check out, here, what are your perspectives? What do you guys bring to the table today?
All right. Well, Katie, do you want to describe a little bit about you and your lenses on this moment?
Sure. We'll start with that just briefly. So I've been studying transformative leadership at the California Institute of Integral Studies in San Francisco for a little while. And the things I'm trying to figure out right now, especially post-election, is how to bring the hurt and hurting people of my liberal communities, my drug policy reform communities, and then my other progressive communities out in California, how I can help them to embrace this concept of bridging when they are hurting very much right now. And that's been the biggest response I'm trying to figure out through this conversation, I hope, is to help them process their mental and emotional state in a more effective way so that they're able to be more constructive and less reactive and be more inclusive and be able to hear what the people who they think that they don't agree with are actually saying. So obviously it seemed like a great place to start with you.
Cool.
And then, what else can I add on to that? That's the biggest thing. We sent out an initial question, I think, earlier, asking what are some possible strategies that individuals could take in responding to this election. And of course, the coming from an activist mindset, the initial response is to collaborate together to bring one another out into the streets and raise awareness in a certain way. And as much as I wanted to participate in these things, because that's kind of where my peers and my nature is going, I'm wondering how that impacts this larger process of bridging and how I can play a more effective role in bringing the diverse sides together at this point. Is there something more positive than protesting? I don't know. We were kind of having some ideas around last night of what would might be more effective in this bridging aspect we're trying to do. And I jokingly brought up the idea of, a peace patrol going around and having everyone meet their neighbors once again for the first time. Or I never did that when I was growing up. And or maybe even just going around and handing out thank you cards or something to try and encourage some sort of a companionship between these diverse sides, just proactively, just before things get even worse. And it seemed very naive and very childish, just kind of thinking of these things, but I just can't help but believe that there's something more effective than actively screaming and yelling that can be done to start the bridging process now while everyone else is really feeling difficult and in hard times. Yeah.
Cool.
So, thank you. I guess as a starting point, maybe would you feel like sharing some of your perspectives on in terms of how we got here, the month and the year and the 2 years leading up to this? What kind of expectations do you feel the mainstream narratives, especially, and the alternative narratives, were preparing people for? So what was the driving inertia behind the reaction that we saw, or does it correlate or not? Is one of my first questions to kind of set the setting.
Wow. Yeah, the context for how things were set up for the whole election and how it all went down. There was a lot of dissatisfaction with many different groups of people. And unfortunately, as I was kind of mentioning in the email, I was back and forth with you, a lot of people are looking at groups and they're not understanding individuals. Mm-hmm. And that's so encouraging more of that type of looking at groups, making the hasty generalization fallacy and encouraging a more division between people has been building for, as I mentioned, millennia and certainly centuries, and then definitely over the last span of years. So we have end of 8 years of Obama and, coming on up. Everything that Obama delivered was to me not a surprise at all. And to the people who voted for Obama, which unfortunately includes me, back in 2008, I moved here. I did not have access to high-speed internet. I did not think clearly about all of the ramifications of the political processes and what a monopoly is. I didn't study economics. So from my perspective, I see that there are certainly people who would have, I would say, a variety of these three qualities how much curiosity is left in them. And at an adult level, there's often, as the older the person is, a diminished level of curiosity. So that they're kind of very, very concluding with the next amount, where there's a lack of flexibility. They're firm on their conclusions, and they're not curious to look into other conclusions. And then there's, of course, the lack of humility, where they would be lacking the skill and ability to say, wow, I could be wrong. In fact, in the past, I have been wrong. Where have I been wrong before? That I chose the incorrect conclusion, evidence totally backs up that I made a mistake in concluding X belief. And you can see a lack of humility. I would say these three qualities are seriously diminished the older the person is generally, but it can be diminished in any age group. So it's really across demographic qualities that I look to measure. So when I try to understand the situation, I see that people have been managed by just really giving them fixed perspectives, very, very rigid and inflexible perspectives and conclusions to hold on to. As like, in other words, kind of like this whole thing is a jungle gym, and you have a bunch of people holding on to certain bars of certain conclusions and other people holding on to other bars. And there's not a lot of swinging between bars and trying out different perspectives, you know, which is what the purpose of the whole thing is. And to me, like when I'm on a jungle gym, I don't just grab a bar and hold, you know, that's called pull-ups, you know? You know? But when I'm flexible, I go from bar to bar, and eventually I even land and look up at the whole structure and understand like what's the structure composed of and like things like that. Because just like as a little child, I'd be curious, what's the structure composed of? Who built it? What's the origin? When the questions like that are asked, that's the questions of someone who's thinking with curiosity, looking for more. So when I understand how flexible people are, then I engage with them. When I understand the curiosity levels, I start to get an idea of where they're coming from. And over time, I can even try to make a bridge with the humility factor to say, you know, I could indeed be wrong about this because I've been wrong about other things in the past. I had a strong conclusion about man-made global warming for a set of years from 2004 at least till 2008, 2009 actually. And then I came upon new evidence and realized that I believe I made the wrong conclusion. Now living on an island really near the coast, seeing absolutely no, you know, raising of water levels anywhere across the world, and certainly noticing that glaciers did not exist, did not diminish or completely go away altogether, as was predicted by this year, plus many, many other facts, I realized I'm pretty sure I was wrong about this conclusion, and I could be wrong about that. Because I'm not flying around. I don't have a Darrell intelligence agency to investigate every little thing. I don't have the ability to corroborate everything. So it does come down to that kind of thing where you have a lot of people, they're making conclusions about, say, Trump is going to do all these nasty things, and other people, that Clinton was going to do all these nasty things. There were these conclusions like that were being made. And I can begin to tell how fixed people were in their conclusions, like how strongly firm were they on that, which then tells me the level of humility. What, you know, like how often has this person had a history of saying the words, I've been wrong about this? Or you know, are they ever ready to engage with saying those words, wow, I think I'm really wrong about that. Thank you for helping me out seeing another way. Because people build their self esteem often on having the right conclusion. It's like they go back into emotionally, like they're back in class. You raise your hand, you have the wrong answer, get the class laughing at you. You can even have the teacher laughing at you, you know, and that's a traumatic event for a child. That type of training exists in adults. That's my claim. That type of training to build your self-esteem on being correct, on having the correct conclusion. What I've learned to do is build my self-esteem on finding the correct conclusion, which means that it's likely going to keep needing to move. I have to have a flexible, moving conclusions. I can't have beliefs that are firm and in stone. There are some that would be less likely to move than others. Like my conclusion that I would prefer a lack of violence in my personal life. I could be convinced of otherwise. But so far, evidence has shown that I would prefer lacking violence in my personal life and more harmony. So that's an example of like, I'm still going to be flexible on it, but so far, you know, from all the evidence I keep adding up over these 44 some years, I'm looking at like, that's one that seems fairly firm, but again, for the academic purpose of discussion, in the moment of thinking about it, I'm not making an action on it, therefore I can be flexible. When people are about to make an action, like right before voting, or before vaccinating a child, or before, you know, enrolling them in a school, a government school that you call public school, that's an action choice. So the moment before an action choice, firmness will be there because that builds confidence. Whether it's a fake it till you make it confidence or confidence that's somewhat based upon evidence. This discussion here is like, we're looking at like a couple different objectives, but what I wanted to do is certainly like to give those tools like that, an attitude assessment internally of curiosity, flexibility, humility, those things, how much are those are going on? And this is internal questions. And then after answering that, it's the other person that you're talking about or conversing with, or if it's multiple people, one at a time, just keeping that in mind, what are those levels for those people? And the best way to find out, of course, is just asking honest and open-ended questions. So that's partially what I'm bringing to the table. And I'm gonna pass it back to you, Morgan.
All right.
Do you have any other objectives in this discussion today, so I can keep on track? You know?
Yeah, I think we're moving naturally towards the other objectives very nicely. Thank you. Katie, do you have anything you want to add to sort of the setting for the election, the pre-election setting?
Gosh, no, I've honestly just been very engaged listening and taking some very useful notes. I feel like I'm getting a quick little rundown of how to communicate what I've been trying to with my friends and peers. So I can't add anything else.
Okay. I definitely like your description of
The jungle gym,
yes. and I definitely feel like, so this leads to my next question about the moment when it becomes an action. In this particular moment after the election, there are certain decisions being made that leave the academic realm and are bringing people to the streets in many cities and many varieties of intensity. And so I'm wondering what kind of, firstly, if some of those reactions, to what degree those reactions are programmed in as part of the adult programming or conditioning, and how much of that is almost knee-jerk reflex for humans, or I don't know, that's my next thought of what's that moment of people going to the street and what they might be feeling inside to make them choose that strategy.
I wonder about this too, Morgan. See, I never know to what degree agent provocateur and other type of purposeful instigation is going on. Yeah. Again, I don't have agents on the ground at various city locations to tell me, oh yeah, we got these operatives in here. They're being paid $1,000 to do these violent acts or to hold up these signs. We have these agents over here who paid $10,000 to fully initiate a beatdown on certain people, or you know, full on violence towards property, bricks through windows, turning over cars and setting them on fire, etc. And we have these agents over there who are also embedded into these news agencies to set up the camera angles and the shots and to basically edit and clip things to make it fully appear a certain whatever perspective based upon the perception management that is being desired, that they're being paid to do. So with all of that in play, I would suspect, based upon my research, that is enough to take all these people who have been massively disenfranchised across their entire lifespan from the moment that they were put into government school, the moment they were made to feel ridiculed by not having the correct answer, by like, you know, having a strong compulsion, almost an addiction to certainty. Mm. you know, across time and space, that they're in that weakened position. They're disenfranchised. They have a lack of awareness of two spheres that I focus on, the spheres of concern and the spheres of influence. So to describe that, a sphere of concern is saying that you have the most biggest sphere of concern is of yourself, your body, your mind, you know, which includes also the emotions going on and all of the things that surround you, your personal effects, your property. That's your first sphere of concern. And your next sphere of concern out that is all the people that you love who are close to you that you actually interact with on a daily or frequent basis that are right there with you, like your partner, your children, etc. And that's like one sphere out. And it keeps going out like that. We're like, I've certainly got a crowd of friends who I know of and I connect with on the weekly or the daily sometimes, but I'm not in their house. So they're not in my house all the time. So they're out. And then there's further people out there, like just they, you know, they're you like you guys, you're far away, you're friends. I connect sometimes, but it's less frequent because of the distance and the time difference. Mm-hmm. So there's that. And then there's all these people like even further out, like the people who consume media that I'm on, and they know of me and they know my messages and they to some degree can have I have influence on them. That's a further like sphere out. And then, you know, like there's that type of thing. Like I'm concerned about them. These are concerns. But I'm more concerned like in proportion to where the closer to where I am. So it's kind of like an apple core, or any type of vegetable or fruit. The core is central. If the core is rotten, if like I didn't take care of myself, I wouldn't be able to do this or articulate these words. If I didn't take care of myself, if I was messed up. And there have been times where I've been messed up because I was concerned about things that were far away from me. As many people after this election and before and during the election were concerned about things very many spheres out from what is right there with their body. And so it's right there. It's like that. Like to clean up one's own house and then like to have interactions with people in the close by. And then from there, like, you know, further and further out, like regionally. Mm-hmm. So before I'm considering the nation ever or anything like that, which talk about an abstraction, I'm considering me. And then all of the people like in my ohana or that's the Hawaiian for family, mm-hmm. the close by people that I connect with frequently. And then from there, the people who are around me, my neighbors, but I'm not fully connected to them. And then it goes like, you know, in the East Hawaii, the whole region of that, then the whole big island, you know, of some 200,000 plus people plus visitors, you know. And then from there, you know, I could say neighboring islands. Well, somewhat, you know, because there's, you know, there is some interaction between inter-island stuff here. Although there's not nearly enough traffic because it's kind of expensive, you know, to go between islands. And then anything that happens on the mainland is like even further away. There's some influence, like when there's legislations going on in places like California that could ripple over to here, such as the folks who push for mandatory things like mandatory vaccinations. If were that to ripple over to here, a lot of people concerned about that. So people are paying attention. It's like smelling mm-hmm. the smoke and which way it blows. Mm-hmm. Spheres of concern are going to be often looked at by people. And so you can query about like, are you concerned about these things? And if they're mentioning things that are really far away, but you take notice that they're not really tending to things right there that's really close to them, mm-hmm. them, their satisfaction with their life, their jobs or business or their interactions with a little further out, their loved one, their family. If you notice that there's enough evidence saying that they don't really have those things in order, then that's a sign that they are displaced with, you know, like they're looking at things far away as important, but the close by things are not being tended. It's like having a rotten core.
Yeah.
You know? So I mean, it's a possibility. I wouldn't try to diagnose people and say, I for sure know that you're not tending to your things close to you. Mm-hmm. But to open up the curiosity factor, are they keeping that in mind, or are they disproportionately paying attention to things far away and not so much close by. And then it goes to the spheres of influence, which is like, what can you do? So the biggest sphere of influence is yourself.
Yeah.
That's basically it. You can't really, there's nothing in the universe that I know of that one can possibly have better and bigger influence over than oneself. So moving on from there, if someone is emotionally volatile, that to me is a sign. If they're frequently volatile, if you know they're raging or in consistent sadness, that shows to me that that's out of control. You know, that's not within the, there are moments of crisis, obviously, moments of devastating problems, of clunky roommates, whatever, you know. there's moments of events that happen that can make it challenging. But that besides that, if it was a consistent situation or if it's based seemingly on events far away, and that's enough to displace their own equilibrium emotionally, mentally, or both, then to me that would be a sign saying, okay, there's a disproportionate kind of focus upon faraway spheres of influence. So like, you know, I have influence over my close by friends who I see frequently. I have less influence over friends who are far away like you, where I talk to you occasionally. And then, you know, I have, I don't know, an unknown influence over the listeners who consume my media, you know, I was like, and then from there, you know, as far as things in the military and the military controlled world that we live in, I don't really see that I have a lot of influence over that, you know, like not yet, you know. And I think that if I was having such big influence, I would put a very large target on me.
Yeah.
And yeah. I would suspect that the lack of target equals the lack of influence. So I keep those things in mind, spheres of concern and spheres of influence. And when I do that, I can then check other people. Where are they focused on, concern or influence wise? So those are two tools that I put out there. It's just when you brought up the knee-jerk reaction, that brings up the whole nature-nurture thing, which many people will conclude that, you know, certain things are just programmed in, you know, and there are some things that are programmed in, but a lot of what I would conclude that we're talking about is nature, is conditioning. From the moment that these children were taken from their parents or delivered by their parents to these schools, put in these traumatic situations where they were literally exposed to ridicule if they got the wrong answer, you know, where they were literally seeking to have certainty in a real strong, I would say, addictive quality of really desiring to be certain about conclusions, whatever those conclusions were, especially the conclusions of the people that they love, especially those ones. So with that type of programming, plus the other things that government schools, which are called public schools, do, obedience, conformity, and a form of philosophical and political apathy, you know, which is a lack of actually desiring to understand the mechanisms for how one thinks, and how one feels. A lack of curiosity. That's a perfect storm of components to create malleable people who are ready to be provoked into creating tragedy. Tragedies like shutting down a highway where people could be trying to, I don't know, get to a hospital, where people are trying to get to a job interview, where people are trying to visit someone that's in danger or in need, you know, where that kind of thing can happen, where as I'm reading, people are actually getting assaulted and killed. I don't know how much of that is done by people who are directly manipulated and being paid to instigate and do so, or how much of it is just from the damages I mentioned. I kind of outlined all like the tools that I'm looking through. So I'll try not to go into super Darrell lecture mode now and I can go into discussion mode, you know.
Well, no worries either way. Is there anything you'd like to add right now?
My gosh. also on this road trip back to the East Coast, we were listening to, I'm going to get the name wrong, the Alternative History of American Education.
Yeah, the Underground.
The Underground, there you go.
John Taylor Gatto's Underground History of American Education. We made it about like halfway through so far.
Pretty decent. So a lot of what you're saying, of course, came up in that, and it really just helps me have a lot more compassion for people who are feeling this issue on either side of the aisle, on whatever they voted for, if they did or not, I'm not really sure it matters. I just think it really helps to paint the picture of how much larger this is and how it's not just about the election, how it's much older, much broader, much more ancient. And that kind of makes the work seem a little bit, I don't know, maybe more valuable, more purposeful of trying to figure out how to make these bridges happen. It's not about an issue anymore. It's very much about humanity at this point. So from that perspective, I really feel like these tools are very helpful, and I'm already excited to figure out how to frame things a little bit differently so I can be more effective. So go into lecture mode. It's very helpful. Please.
So one of the main things I wanted to brainstorm with the three of us were kind of for the moment of action, when these things stop becoming academic and you feel some need to take some kind of action, I was hoping to draft some alternatives for people who want to protest in the streets, different actions that they can take that would deliver more predictable and beneficial results, and what like. All I can think of so far is trying to get more dialogue going. I feel my gut says that in the next days and weeks that there's going to be a big discussion that we would not have otherwise had about parsing out the Trump supporters. So whereas right now the liberal half is content still to say like all Trump supporters are very racist and support sexual predator. You know, like that tagline is still holding for now, but I don't see it as strategically viable for him to maintain that character at least in the next couple months. And I picture a pivot either way, but I think we're going to have a conversation that we wouldn't have had if Hillary had been elected, that we have to face this part of the country head on a bit more in the national dialogue and have a discussion about it that we haven't really had yet. So one of the things that I picture is, instead of our peers protesting in the streets, trying to maybe go a couple counties inland and go to a town hall there and start hearing each other out, with the kind of tools that you use. And so far that's like the best case scenario I could picture of people's reactions being converted into a different kind of energy that would produce better results for all of us. But what do you think of that kind of concept? And can you think of other things or even approaches people could have if they do choose to protest when they confront people who are of diametrically opposed position? How can they start to engage with a Trump supporter, for example, if you feel up to giving a concrete example? But either way.
Okay. So when it comes to how can they confront and talk to a Trump supporter? Okay. This is where the intellectual method takes over. Who's the they? Say, okay. I need to know who the they is. Basically, with the knowledge of the definitions of who each party is,
yes,
you have a potential for building a bridge. But with a lacking of knowledge of like, we need to build a bridge to that island. But it's like, wait, from what island to what island? You know,
all right.
I need to know, you know.
Can I make up an example then?
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, so I'm picturing one of our fellow drug policy reform activists who, we are very excited. Cannabis won, cannabis got more votes than president this year. It's the only thing the country seems to be behind in terms of the national stage, but we're excited about that. But there are a lot of kind of like libertarian leaning progressive liberals, that's a good stereotype, a hasty generalization. So I'm picturing like a character like that, mid-20s, maybe college still, talking to a Trump supporter who's also in college I'm going to say same sex for now and both white for simplicity.
And male?
Or? And male. Well, either way, but I think male is a more useful scenario to investigate.
Well, okay. That makes like a lot of potential bridges right there. Because, you know, we got a lot in common, you know. You know, when it comes to things like conflict resolution, which is an art and science that I've been looking into, it really comes down to finding what are the commonalities, what are the points of agreement. And what most people would probably find as common and as a point of agreement is that the systems of government are highly corrupt. Mm. And corrupted. And what to do about it, the strategies, these people that you mentioned, they might differ. Mm-hmm. But just to understand that, like, corrupted, yes. And also to, you know, to verbalize that there are emotions going on, you know, like that there's anger about this corruption. And if you're going to be honest about it, there's sadness about the corruption. Mm-hmm. There's fear about the corruption. So when it comes to the case of guys, for many of us guys, we're taught at a young age that to display fear or sadness is a sign of weakness. Mm-hmm. We've got two emotions to share, happiness and anger. That is acceptable. The other ones are not. Okay, so just to start with that, unless you're trained mm-hmm. with emotional literacy skill and you understand that there's a value in being vulnerable, it's sort of like the skill of being able to fight naked. It shows courage. Whereas if you can only fight when you're fully armored, you know, what happens when you're naked? What are you? You lose all skill. So it's similar to the art of stoicism, of like negative visualization and all of that type of thing. So when making a bridge from one to the other, I'm always looking to see what are the commonalities and to just put right out there, just as it would be for our discussion, what are the objectives? Just put it out there verbally on the table. Like, my objectives are for us to connect on the level of what we definitely have in common. My objectives are to have some level of a bridge between us, metaphorically speaking, so that we can communicate more effectively. And in doing that, I'm going to try to demonstrate that I respect, you know, like that there's respect going back both ways. That would be some of the objectives. If the other person doesn't have these objectives, that's their freedom to choose that. Respect means respecting that choice. You know, the difference between a demand and a request. Difference is, very simply, a request is ready to hear a no and be okay with that. A demand is not. That's a huge difference. I say this in front of many couples who are together. I say, like, you know, so you understand the difference, right? Like, this is really critical. You know, when you make a request, are you really ready to hear the no? Or are you, if you're going to be making a demand about things, you know, please understand the friction that's likely to occur. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because there's a history of demands that have happened to all of us that I know, any adult that I can point to. And that's going to, that point of friction is going to generate three Fs, the fight, the flight, or freeze, you know. And those are three signs to say, you know, when you see someone fight, flight, freeze kind of thing, any of those, that means that they may have interpreted a request as a demand. Like, I'm trying to make a bridge. I want to find commonality. They could take that as a demand. I have to find commonality. I've got to make a bridge with you. You have no choice. You know? Or you suck for not engaging with me on this level. A diagnosis and that's not requested, you know. People will interpret the D's, you know. D's are part of the work that I do. Demands, unrequested diagnoses, deserve-oriented language, which is huge, mm-hmm. and denial of responsibility, especially emotional responsibility. So when keeping those in mind, I'm just always trying to understand what am I trying to do. But I want to give you an example of a failure of me failing using these methods a few days ago. just reading in Facebook after the election, you know, and some of my friends living up the hill here, they are sad, they're angry, Some of them are making those hasty generalizations of all the Trump supporters being racist, homophobic, bigots of various and other slurs like that. But the other one was just a family that I know and respect, and they were basically mentioning the mother part where she was mentioning that she's upset, that the dad part was mentioning he's upset and he doesn't know how to explain it to his daughter who's 9. The mother is explaining that her 9-year-old daughter's perspective of being worried about their friend who's over in California who's gay and what's going to happen to her because she's gay, and then we have a Trump president. And I'm just shaking my head and I'm feeling the frustration and the anger because I'm like, you're messing up your daughter. Nothing's going to happen to your gay friend in California today or this year or even in 4 years, or it's just not like, I don't see it happening. There's huge support for being gay over there. It's just not going to happen, especially being a gay woman. You know, that's just by many considered pretty hot. So, you know, it's just not going to happen. You know, there's a lot of support for that type of thing. Yes, there's always going to be homophobes everywhere. Everywhere. It's just going to happen. So I was angry at first. I was like, you know, like, first of all, like, no, you know, you guys are not looking at spheres of influence and spheres of concern. Second of all, you're inculcating your daughter to, you know, believe exactly as you are instead of encouraging her how to think and how to make choices and decisions. But of course she's going to choose the ones that you do because she loves you, worships you, and considers that everything you do must be logical and rational. Because that's all she knows. And, you know, that's the way it is. So my first reaction to them was to be angry at them and, like, just pissed at them, basically. And these are my friends. And then my next reaction was realizing that I was out of balance. And why was that? Because I was not tending to myself. There were other things that I was so needing, and I wasn't taking care of them. And once I took a moment to take care of them, or at least plan to take care of them, I felt more imbalanced. Just it's a visualization exercise that I do. And then I go back to thinking about it. So how would I be better served, you know, to handle the situation? And I realized that I could do that by making an offering to both of them for caring and connection, to say, hey, I know the election went down in a way that you didn't like, and I just want to say, I realize you guys are busy, but I'd be happy to be an ear to hear you out on your feelings and your thoughts about the whole matter, hear what you plan to do about the whole thing, everything like that. And don't worry about getting back to me, but if, you know, please do if you want to, you know, to make a bridge like that, to make an offering. I didn't do that, by the way. I mean, cause I did the cost benefit analysis and I realized that they're going to be fine. My energy is spent in other ways, like producing media like this, you know, that's where my energy is better spent. So it was an example of how I didn't tend to my inner emotional core. And so I read something on Facebook and I instantly have my New York training of double middle finger come out, you know, just like, you know, just total F you idiot. You know, why don't you just kill yourself? You know, you just make the world a better place without you, because honestly, you could do way better than that, you know. Or think like I do. I'll give you two choices, you know. You can see how that's out of balance, right? Yeah. I mean, that's not hard.
A worldview you can't refuse.
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of the mafia Darrell, you know. So it's an emotional reaction that I can indulge in periodically just to understand, because like I can get to the core of Darrell. I do work periodically to try to get to the bottom of things. And when I do that, I can usually get to something more substantial. How to make a better world is what this stuff is all about. So I gave you that example because first I wanted to demonstrate that even with all these skills, it doesn't mean that I'm perfect with them. Right. I've only been training with them for several years. If someone else had given me these skills decades ago, I'd be more proficient, you know. But this is the level of skill that I'm at right now. So when I see people engage in the fantasy that their vote counted, which is what my friends were doing. The fantasy. I know that they know better. I know that they have access to the internet. I know that they know what the Electoral College is. I know what they know, that voter fraud exists. So it's like a compartmentalized knowledge of the voting, and then the voting fraud plus the Electoral College, which is more voter fraud. And putting those, it's like there's a wall between those. So they're literally not thinking with all of the facts. They're thinking with only the convenient ones that help them maintain the emotions and the thoughts that they want to continue. It's like they're stuck in the O and the F, and the O and the F, basically. They never get down to what motivates their feelings and what obviously changes their thought perceptions, which, you know, thoughts are in the O, the observation part. Feelings are in the F part, you know.
Could you please hash that out briefly for any friends that might be less familiar? Bouncing back between the O and the F?
Yeah, very simply. So it's referring to, you know, a philosophy, a methodology called nonviolent communication. It's built on beginning with observations, and that includes every five senses plus thoughts that you could write down that are relevant, everything like that. And then also noticing feelings. And I do mean real feelings. Of a real feeling, I'll give you an example of the four core feelings. They are happiness and variants thereof, of satisfaction and completeness and things of that nature. There is fear, which is related to anything related to fear, from mild anxiety to full terror. Then there is sadness, and then there is anger, from mildly miffed and frustrated to full rage. Those are the four core feelings. There are combination feelings, such as shame, which is usually coupled with a thought, or disgust. You know, these are like combination things. But they really come down to the four, very simply. And the feelings are like the same sensors in our skin, that, in my opinion, from my research, basically. They are there to show what's going on in real time. To get like a sensor. So like I have heat sensors in my skin and I have pressure sensors in my skin.
Nice, yeah.
And that helps me know what's going on. Mm-hmm. To push that away or disconnect the feelings would be like turning off my heat and touch sensitivity. That is dangerous, you know? And it's the same exact thing. So those are the first two components of nonviolent communication. The next one is to identify abstract qualities that they call needs in that lingo that are like adjectives that inspire feelings to happen. And then from there, requests is the final, it's the R part of the OFNR, observations, feelings, needs, which I call motivational factors, values, desires, including physiological needs. Mm-hmm. And then moving on to requests, which I call strategies and actions. Like a strategy before you implement it, an action after you implement it. Like that. It's very, very simple. And one of the strategies you can do is to make a request and then take action on that. Mm-hmm. So I make it very explicit like that. So instead of going all the way through, I see the election results. I have these thoughts going on. I notice my feelings of frustration. If I was like, say, let's just say I'm pretending I'm my friends up the hill there. I notice the anger. I notice the fear. I notice the sadness, it's all like swirling together. It's like, you know, jumping back and forth, all of them at once, some of them together, flipping back and forth. And they're just up there, those two. They're not identifying that what they wanted, the qualities were harmony, safety and security, connection even, or clarity, you know, continuity, where you have things that were, you know, like nice and awesome before, and you want that to continue. You want continuity. It's a very base need, is continuity. And when you identify those as qualities that are desired, then you have a chance to take the time to think about your strategy so that when you take action, it can be more effective. So what I see, of course, is people are stuck like that. They're noticing their thoughts and they're you know, experiencing their feelings and going back and forth. The feelings will inspire more thoughts. The thoughts will inspire more feelings. The feelings will inspire more thoughts. It's like back and forth like that. And that's what I'm referring to. So when you see someone in the observations, feelings, ping pong, you can be like, hi, can I join you in this game? You know? And like with many NVC neophytes, people who are new to the whole science of using nonviolent communication, naming someone else's feelings might be a good thing. It very well might not be a good thing, because that's a very sensitive place.
Yeah.
Especially for a guy who does not want having his mm-hmm. certain feelings being named out loud, that's a very sacred and sensitive place. And I'm making a hasty generalization that guys don't want to have their feelings discussed. Some guys would. That would be a great way to connect with some people.
Yeah.
And some women would, and some men and women mm-hmm. and children would find that you are intruding into a very sacred area of their being. Mm-hmm. And you're also making a presumption. You know, it's like, sort of like the example of saying, now, Morgan, calm down. I know that you're angry, you know. That's like the exact thing to get you not calm down, to get you more angry, you see. But to say, hey, I wanted to connect with you and hear you out. I want to share that I care about you, you know, if that's genuine and real and you have a previous connection to the person. Or intellectually, I really want to understand your perspective on the recent events of this election. I'm basically polling all kinds of people on this one. Would you be willing to share it with me on that?
Yeah.
You know, like that. So some people, they want their intellect. They want to stay up there. And so mm-hmm. join them, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. And some people are in their emotions. If so, respectfully ask to join them, you know. That's what I would say. So is that clear on tactics there?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, pretty clear.
Yeah, it almost feels to me, as you described that the feelings are kind of like identifying a symptom, and then the motivating values is like the root of the problem. Like that's how you start to identify a cure for, you know, the feelings that are a symptom of some deeper problem, some need.
Right, right. It's really very simple. Values. And what I call the motivational factors, I use the word values because it's simple. It's, you know, six letters. it's fairly understandable. Everyone has values, some values, and I'm referring to abstract qualities that were highly desirable for a person across their lifetime, however long that is, and it forms the motives for whatever actions they take and whatever strategies they form from there, basically. And it also, like this, the sensors in the skin, you know, to pick up what's going on, the values are the impetus. They're like a structure. Mm-hmm. And then the observations and how that's doing is always being basically assessed by each individual. So when you deal with individuals on an individual basis, you can use these tools. If you deal with a group and hallucinate that you can collect them all together as having the same observations, the same thoughts, and the same feelings, you are basically hallucinating, in my opinion, because they actually have different values. Each individual, unless they're like the Borg and they're all connected like a collective, which I don't see evidence of. Yeah, resistance is futile, but you know, like unless they are connected like that, they're all individuals. So as individuals, you can actually have a chance to use real tools to connect. There are ways to, you know, engage a crowd. Like I can go up in front of a crowd and deliver a speech and engage audience and check, you know, attention span and sometimes even deal with a heckler. But I mean, that's a specific thing. They're a group. They are allowed to be passive like that. And group think is part of the training that I was referring to with the government schooling going on, where conformity and a type of apathy of just like going with the inertia of it, where everyone is conforming to the same type of thing. Like if they were all like, not our president, not our, like holding a sign and like shouting the same chant or whatever like that would be, you know, like that's like a thing basically saying, oh, I see that you know, this is important enough to you that you're going to take time out of your day to do that, to make a sign, to chant to your horse, you know, like that type of thing. That's data.
Yeah.
That's a very devoted person.
Yeah.
It's also a very conforming person.
Yeah.
You know, so I look to understand what level of, you know, where is this person at? And always keeping in mind, what's your objective? Are you wanting to engage with this person? If so, I suggest make it explicit.
Yeah.
You know, explain what your objectives are in the connection process. Mm-hmm. Give them a chance. Make it a request and make it explicit that they can say no.
Yeah.
Say, I'm ready to hear a no on that. You know, like and track your audience. Are they up in their head? Are they in their emotions? Wherever they are, join them or make the offer to join them rather, you know, instead of thinking that wherever they are, they need to be in the other place. Mm-hmm. That's a big mistake that I see in the circles I run in.
Yeah. You know,
mm-hmm. Where, you know, oh, you're too up in your head, Darrell. You don't touch about your feelings. Have you guys ever heard that you're too in your head?
Yeah.
I have heard this many times to me. Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to discuss these tactics. They are intellectual. How the hell can I describe them otherwise? I could maybe, you know, I don't know, kabuki theater or something like that. But you know, honestly, it doesn't get the message across as clearly, you know. But I can touch upon my feelings too and demonstrate that. I can demonstrate that I make mistakes, that I have humility, and I can make a connection with that too, as I was describing like that. The tactics they are used is an individual situation each time.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you're going to engage an entire crowd, pretty tricky, just like it is to do stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
That is a tricky thing because you need to get the mass of everyone and somehow deliver to them something that they desire. That's a trick. That's a huge trick.
Yeah.
Military perspectives have been engaging this for a long time. The you know, study the military and their tactics. Look up perception management for you, the listeners of this video in the future. You can look into this. Understand that this is a very old science of perception management, and it's gone through many iterations and many different names.
Yeah.
And once you can start with the center of your spheres of concern and influence, yourself, and unplug how other things impact you, you have a chance to understand what it is that you're keeping as an objective and how does that objective serve you.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll put it back to you guys as a question. Having heard me deliver to you guys these methods, do you have any further ideas or concerns based upon like what I've given you?
Well, I really like, one of my big takeaways is starting the interaction with the explicit, you know, communication of objectives. And I don't think you actually said it, but boundaries too, is kind of implicit in that perhaps. But that seems really huge. The whole idea of starting the conversation with the explicit check that it's going to be a conversation. Or what's the image that you use? Our discussion.
This is not a discussion. You
know? Are we having a discussion? You know.
Are we having a discussion? That's a really good question. So that flowchart, our discussion flowchart. Everyone out there, you can look it up. The
link. I'll edit it in too.
Yeah, so. There's a million links to the our discussion flowchart, but it's something that I've discussed on previous podcasts. It's something that I highly say, edit it, take it with a grain of salt, but the component questions are useful because there are people out there who are firm in their convictions and their conclusions. They have a belief system, and that system is not open for an audit. Like religious folks, it is like that, where Jesus is their savior is a firm conclusion, and they're not opening to audit that, and that's a thing. So if they're coming from that space, they're open to a sermon or lecture on that. And they're not open to questioning it, usually. And if that's where they're at, that's just like identify it. And part of respect of individual boundaries is to understand that their conclusions and what goes on in their head and in their heart is their ownership. That's what they own. And it's not what anyone else owns. Mm-hmm. So to respect what they own is the potential setup for them to respect what I own and what you guys own. Mm-hmm. It's a setup like that to hopefully not put undue pressure on it, to like anything that could be interpreted as a diagnosis of you're wrong for holding that belief or conclusion.
Yeah. Yeah.
And those diagnoses are going to come at us. Mm-hmm. So I'm just putting that out there.
Yep.
I was just, you think you brought it back perfectly. What I'm hearing is that mutual respect is just the initial bridge building. I mean, that's the first brick. That's the first piece of any of it. So that's hugely helpful. And I mean, Morgan, like you said too, it's about the boundaries and it's about understanding where someone's at. And you can't meet someone where they're at if you don't know where they're at, and you don't know where they're at if you don't ask the questions and start with questions instead of demanding that you understand where they're at. So this is incredibly enlightening. It really, really is. And I'm very thankful that you took the time.
Cool. Yeah, go on, Morgan.
I like what you mentioned about bringing up questions, asking the other person questions as a main tool. And one of the qualifiers you used earlier was open-ended questions, too, on how much more bridge building that can create than, especially, you know, the opposite extreme of an open-ended question is like a great leading question that, you know, steps them right into the next step of your logical crushing of their worldview, which is, you know, not the conversation, not the discussion we want either.
Right. Do you ever look up Larkin Rose's 5 questions as an example?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, you know, you out there listening, look them up. They're easy to find and they're compelling questions for someone who is interested in auditing conclusions.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And they are an excellent way of shutting down connection to anyone who is fixed in their beliefs and conclusions.
Mm-hmm.
Because the internal turmoil that happens when faced with one's own hypocrisy,
yeah,
with an inconsistency, so like there's friction between conclusions, between the evidence and the belief, that friction, as it's being pointed out, is going to be emotional turmoil for the person. If they have minimal emotional balancing skills, that's pretty common. So they're going to be in turmoil. Mm-hmm. And it's like basically throwing a bomb over to the other island that explodes. And now you're going to try to make a bridge to that, you know, devastated island, basically. You know.
That's American foreign policy.
The pier that you built on, that Katie, that you mentioned, is respect. Respect is an earned quality that's abstract.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not given. It's never given in my experience. It is always earned. It is earned through, you know, trust. Now, of course, you see little kids can be ready to give the gift of trust right away. Little young animals, puppies and kittens, are ready to give the trust because they're born into a helpless state of captivity of a sort, defenselessness and captivity. But over time, as you know, any older child or actual adult, trust and respect is earned, and an earned situation. And it's a currency. And once damaged, it can be challenging to repair.
Yeah.
So it is like that, to build up these peers of respect and trust, and certainly to make it known, I want to make a bridge. Are you willing to do so? And trust me, I've got other people to make bridges to, so you're not the only one, but I'm open to take a no, like that type of thing.
Mm-hmm. No pressure.
No pressure is maybe the best idea, you know. And people will interpret the words in all kinds of interesting ways, you know. Yeah. Like, I think you've, Morgan, you've seen my words being interpreted by folks over at Gnostic Media as an example. Like, this is all some form of mind control.
Yeah. Mealy and mouth, Darrell.
That's me. That's quite a diagnosis, huh? Yeah. The purpose is this. I would love to control my mind. I would rather no one else do that.
You want a monopoly.
It's kind of the same way as I would like to control my car, and I want no one else to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at least unless I actually lend it to someone, mm-hmm, explicitly, or have them drive me. But those are specific key moments, you know, like mostly not. So it's like that. I've been laying out to you like some of the basic tools that I use. Just like it's really very straightforward. The stuff will be in each part of my work, online course, etc. All of this kind of stuff. I'm hoping to make this stuff really popular and sexy.
Yes.
Know? And I'm hoping to make it like accessible to young folks. I'm hoping to really put it out there so that when things like this election happen in the future, it's way less of a shocker and a lot more of a yep, you know, saw that coming, you know, and then the aftermath of it all for the people who are still stuck, for all of the, I don't know, what was it, something like under 40% of actual voters who were allowed to vote, that for that minority of actual engaged voters to not be surprised at that the outcomes didn't happen the way they wanted, for those who, where they got the outcome from the election, so-called, that they think they got the outcome that they wanted,
right,
as the years go on, they can then experience the sadness and the frustration and the fear as they see what the actual, you know, the representative that they voted for is going to do does. Mm-hmm. There'll be a lot of time. I mean, there's a lot of like, welcome back, anti-war left. We missed you.
Yeah, right.
Right now. Totally. We missed you. You were
What's
all
going on? What time is it? Are we, oh, okay, it's time. Time,
is it time again? Yeah. What is it? Like a Republican president usually wars overseas, Democratic president, massive like attack on civil liberties at home. Mm. You know, that's been a pattern for a long time. But at this point, since they're both one and the same critter, and it's really like both at once always happening to some degree. Mm-hmm. This is a fascinating world, you guys. Like I'm just looking to put the pieces together best I can, and I'm looking to find out what can I do effectively with all this stuff. Mm-hmm. So if you have any ideas, I'm all ears.
Yeah. Well, I would love to hear a couple more like case studies essentially of your translation matrix. So as it applies to like one of our kind of scenarios with a Trump supporter, like when let's start with like the wall. When you hear someone saying like, well, we need a wall, and that's urgent, and I feel strongly about that, and you know, whether or not they're recognizing that, you know, how would you translate the needs or your best guess of the needs, the values, the motivating values that they're looking to satisfy with that strategy?
Okay. So I know what you meant by translation matrix. It's like the how to translate any of the four Ds. Those are demands, unrequested diagnoses, deserve-oriented language, and denial of responsibility. So first I'm just, you know, setting the stage with the components.
Thank you.
I translate a demand as a form of request. It shows me what the person is after. So it's very, very simple. And once I understand what they're after, I can potentially see what motivated that. In other words, what are the values that they so strongly want? And so in that case, if they're demanding that a wall be built, mm-hmm. and they might be demanding that I help pay for it, mm-hmm. I think that some of the values would be safety and security, mm-hmm. which, you know, when that's in danger, there's fear, there's anger.
Yeah.
You know, those are the two that would be engaged like that. Mm-hmm. And safety and security would be behind that type of demand. Usually demand means urgency. Yeah. Actually, usually like each of the four Ds implies some form of urgency, mm-hmm. because it's obviously less skillful than making a request.
Sure.
You know? So there's that. And once I translate all that, I feel calmer like that. I demand that you and me and everyone, we're all just gonna join Trump and pay for this wall. It's like, okay. With my intellectual mind, I also keep in mind, by the way, this person has no actual control over me. So, you know, like saying, I demand that you support the New York Giants. Like, okay. You know, I hear your demand, and I translate it as a request to support the Giants. And for winning the Super Bowl or whatever. You know, like, I'm not in charge and neither are you. So I'm okay with that. You know, like, I, you know, like, I'm not in that fantasy, but, you know, this person with a Trump wall, they are in that fantasy.
Yeah.
So I kind of understand, like, where that's coming from. Now, when it's an actual pointing a gun demand, that's different.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like when I go to the border in Canada or some things mm-hmm. like that, where I've seen an actual demand to get out of the car and shit like that.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
I've seen that happen.
Yeah.
The unrequested diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
Like a Trump wall person could say, one of those chaotic anarchists who didn't support our country and our troops, and, you know, doesn't support our president, and that's an unrequested diagnosis. I don't call myself an anarchist. The label, which I only use because it's applicable, is individual. It's the only label that I will take. You know. Other than Darrell, you know, I am an individual, and I'm not part of any collective coercively in my mind. On paper, of course, I have been coerced into all types of things on paper, like for expediency and just float, you know, moving around and such. But in my mind, I'm an individual. So when someone gives me an unrequested diagnosis, I translate that as a desire for clarity and understanding. They put me in a box, they put them in a box, they put everyone in a box, put everything in a box.
Hmm.
The boxes are labeled. It makes them organized.
Mm-hmm.
It makes them understandable.
Mm-hmm.
It might be less accurate, but just like as if I wrote spoons on a box that was composed of pillows, you know, it's not accurate. So I understand the desire was accuracy and clarity and understanding. The result of it is less relevant than why are they doing it. Once I understand why they're aiming for that, why are they giving me the label of anarchist
mm-hmm.
and unloyal and disrespectful? Why am I being given those labels? Is because this is what they are trained to do, is put labels mm-hmm. on everyone and everything, themselves included, which mm-hmm. is the worst.
Yeah.
You know? And once I absorb that, acknowledge of that, like, I understand this is what they're trained to do. They've trained themselves to do, and they've been trained to do.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, I can connect with them on that. I was trained to do that too.
Mm-hmm.
I used to give people labels like a-hole and other things like that. And I do it less now
mm-hmm.
because I understand that whenever I do that, I'm engaging in something that's way less productive, and I'm not clearly seeing the world. I've lost my curiosity for discovery,
mm-hmm.
and I've lowered my flexibility. I'm rigid and fixed in my firm definition.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm lacking in humility in the sense of, where could I be wrong on this? Where could I be missing something, some nuance, some new information?
Mm-hmm.
So it's a self-assessment thing. The third one is deserve-oriented language. When you get into the realm of rights, mm-hmm. you know, and things of that nature. From the Trump supporter, let's see where it would be. The deserve-oriented language would be, you know, I can imagine deserve, you know, that would be more in the next one, demand, but we deserve. Give me an example of what would a Trump be saying he deserves?
Coming up with is that a Trump supporter saying you would not deserve something, or
you deserve to be punished because you didn't vote for Trump, or you didn't support, you don't support the president. You deserve to be punished. Mm-hmm. It's punishments and rewards kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you deserve to be punished this way and that way. You deserve to be punished because you didn't pay your taxes. You deserve this or that type of thing. And to me, I translate deserve-oriented language. There would probably be behind that a little bit of a desire for ease and efficiency as a value.
Mm-hmm.
It is definitely a form of continuity, though. If that person very likely was punished and rewarded for things in their past, it helps a sense of continuity across their lifetime if they can dish out a punishment.
Mm-hmm.
It puts them now in the, like, a whole drama is being replayed in front of them again.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're in the power position of dishing out the punishment instead of back when, you know, they were a little smaller and they were receiving the punishment, you know? So it's a form of sacred drama for them. to really engage like that. And when you see them engaging in that as a fantasy and a sacred drama and that type of thing of trying to connect with the continuity of their life, of how much they have these ways of thinking are engaged in them, it begins opening up the door of compassion. Oh, they want ease and efficiency and they want continuity. This is how they are going to get to harmony. Harmony mm-hmm. is achieved by punishments and rewards,
mm-hmm.
threats, like that, you know? And that's a strategy, is the punishment and reward, but the desire of value is harmony. Mm-hmm. And once I identify that that's what they're after, again, I can feel a bit more calm and cool about mm-hmm. this Trump supporter. Like, again, I keep in mind, intellectually, they don't have power over me. They are mm-hmm. not going to be able to dish out punishments to me, especially mm-hmm. over here, you know, where I am. I mean... And it's just not going to happen. So that helps me calm down. And I just understand them as a human, as a real human who's truly in their own thing. And I can connect with them on desiring harmony and desiring safety and security
mm-hmm.
and continuity across their lifespan. And the final one is denial of responsibility. And that could be... denying responsibility, that could be for a Trump supporter. See, I didn't prepare for this one. How would a Trump supporter deny being responsible? Like, they could say, like, you know, like, those people, they infuriate me, those idiot Clinton supporters, you know, they infuriate me. In other words, that person, the Trump supporter, has no control over their emotional terrain. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. out there. It's them.
I see. Yeah.
You know, and it's not. And so, again, it's a desire for ease and efficiency. It's mm-hmm. so much easier if it's someone else and not you.
Mm-hmm.
Just like when you're a little child being picked up and cared for and wiped and everything like that. It's so much easier if someone else tends to your emotional need as a child is like an instant response because mm-hmm. you're captive. You can't take care of yourself. You can't wipe yourself. And you express the emotions so that someone takes care of you or you die. It's that mm-hmm. simple.
Mm-hmm.
And as you get bigger, you have the opportunity to learn to care for yourself. Well, if you were taught to outsource care for yourself in some certain circumstances, mm-hmm. that will produce the result that we're seeing with that, where they made me angry. Those people, you know, they upset me. And so therefore, I'm just going to type up a storm on Facebook and I'm just going to they made me troll them and insult them. I deny that I'm responsible. And whenever it's a denial of responsibility, I do see that there's a desire, usually a value of ease and efficiency, of harmony. It could be safety. You see, like the whole list of the CNBC.org needs inventory, you can look mm-hmm. that up. They're adjectives.
Yeah.
And the adjectives form the basis of motives, of strategies. And once you know that, you can see each individual has precision type motives or values that inspire their whatever deed that they're using.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When you translate that and you understand what motivates them, you have a chance to connect with them internally. Yeah. You can keep it all silent in your head mm-hmm. to say, I see that, just for the purpose of seeing them as a human being.
Yeah,
who has their own struggles that you have no idea how hard it is to be them.
Yeah,
you know, and in doing that, they become a person again and not a mm-hmm. Trump supporter,
mm-hmm.
or a Clinton supporter, or an anarchist, you know,
right.
or a voluntary or whatever the label is. They come back to being that one label that I prefer. They're an individual,
mm-hmm.
and with that, there's a connection possibility. So that mm-hmm. was. That was me doing the best I could to do the translation matrix.
Very good. Yeah, I heard that, you know, we can identify and find understanding in recognizing the other person's need for safety and security. And that would equally apply to a Trump supporter wanting a wall or a Hillary supporter scared of World War III via Trump instead of Hillary, because they're equally terrified, you know, in beforehand and now I assume still. A lot of my friends are much more scared of Trump's effects on world war possibilities than Hillary's, because they don't look at the same information we do. But but valid or not, we can identify that and start that as a nice foothold to get the respect, you know, start, use it as a way to give them respect. It's an opportunity in recognizing that internally. It gives us something tangible, something we can kind of feel and you know, fire some mirror neurons around to start sending some respect back. So that was one of the things I heard, and I always enjoy hearing you discuss these kind of scenarios. But is there anything you want to ask?
I did have a question as I'm trying to figure out this framing. So not all Trump supporters are racists or rapists, I imagine. We know this is true. But but what about when those spheres and those circles of influence are not far away for your aunt or your cousin who's a lesbian woman living in California? What about when it's a very different situation and you are actually fearing for your life and your bodily harm and the well-being of your family because you're in an area where the Trump supporter is actually out causing some very terrifying things to happen? What about in those situations? My question that was kind of at the very back of my mind during the last little part of this was, well, when does nonviolent communication fail? What do I do in those situations where it really is a matter of life and death? I mean, we work with groups that are active in every single state in this country, and they're not all safe. So there are times when the fear is real, and when it comes to nonviolent communication, how do I help with that reframing? And how do I get those bridges to be built to people who are actively proposing doing harm to others?
It's a great question, Katie. I love answering this one over and over because I get it multiple times. How does NBC fail in these circumstances of potential and active violence between people, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Individuals, even not, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just to check, is my audio still okay?
Sound great to me.
Okay, just checking. I'm not hearing it perfectly, and that's kind of concerning to me. So, you know.
Okay. All right.
Okay, but here's the deal. The skills that I'm promoting, I promote them as internal applications, as the major, okay? So just like in actual combat, to be emotionally volatile is to put yourself at a disadvantage. That's just the way it is. If you're going to be volatile emotionally and you're out of balance, you created disharmony. Like when I was pissed off at these people up the hill, I was out of balance. If that was combat, I would be at a disadvantage. If there was a real combat situation going on, I would want to calm myself and be clear and be aware of many, many variables because I can utilize them for de-escalation purposes. By knowing myself and calming myself, I can have more variables be taken in. By being emotionally volatile, by not doing the skill set that I described inside of myself, I am at a disadvantage. I have put blinders on. I am seeing it like this. I am likely to utilize logical fallacies, making hasty generalizations, appeals to certain authorities, correct or not. Yeah. Appeal to other fallacies as well. Any of those things. By putting myself at a disadvantage, that's a big problem. So the first thing I'm thinking is, that's a problem. It's an inside job. The second part is, after I balanced myself, because there's never a time where, especially in real combat, where you talk to, you know, simulated combat like sparring and the MMA and things like that, you talk to these people, a lot of what they do before the fight is posturing. In the actual combat arena, they're aiming to be so clear and balanced, harmonious inside, not the highs and lows. This is not the ecstasy and the agony. They're not using anger to strike harder. Those people lose, by and large. They are using a balancing technique that they've learned from their coaches and from their training. They balance themselves, and that's what real combat is all about. When you study real combat, they generally, I mean, of course, someone who's bigger can always win, and someone who's stronger can win and faster can win. And you may see clumsy fighting techniques where some of those people will utilize their anger, or they will utilize their out of control, you know, type emotions and things of that nature. But by and large, you know, for professionals who do this, that's not it. So to answer it, Katie, it's like this. There's not a single instance I can think of where keeping that balance is not useful. And then from there, I'm looking at de-escalation of the situation. I'm taking in all the variables that I possibly can. And then I look at the other person. If they are out of control, they are taking their poker hand and they are tipping it to me fully. They're showing me all of their values and motives, what motivates them. If I can find a way to get their motives satisfied, they will likely not have a conflict with me with anyone. Because if their motives are satisfied, they're okay. That's what inspires their whole antagonism and violent response in the first place. So it really comes down to that. Like, do I want to be aware of these variables, or would I wish to say, as some people would prefer, ignore these variables? You know, because some people promote that idea, like to turn off one's own internal emotions. Like I say, similar to turning off my temperature and pressure sensitivity on my skin, you know, or the being able to smell smoke, you know, turning off certain senses. That's a danger to me.
Yeah.
Those things are there for a good reason. They were built in for a reason, to like a proximity alarm going on. So that was me answering that. What I'm aiming to do is, see, I'm looking to add to the respect and trust bank account that's going on between me and the other person. It's an abstraction, you know, but it's a bank account nonetheless. And it's hard to add to this account, but it's really easy to empty the account. You know, it's exactly that kind of account where, you know, it's a challenging thing. Like it's like buying Bitcoin through Coinbase for the first time. It's a pain in the ass. You know? But then once you've started doing it, it's done and easy. And once you own it, it's so easy to spend. Easily done. It's done. You know, it can be sent away really easily. So, you know, just putting it out there that these are tools that I'm promoting, or methods. And I'm going to be curious to see not only how you guys like these tools, but also any of the viewers for this media, people who like message us. Then I would like to find out, how does this work for people? And troubleshooting through real life applications is what I'm looking for.
Yeah, a big part of my concern is are the streets right now, and I felt in advance that there would likely be protests around the country no matter who was the victor, given the preparations for the big, you know, America's next top president, big day. And I guess I never seriously thought that Trump would come away with it. I thought Hillary would rig it enough on her side to ensure, but you know, everything's possible. Nothing's, you know, it's a chaotic world. There's a lot of variables.
There is.
But I was, so it's been kind of interesting for me to be surprised at seeing, you know, our quote, our side, you know, like the side that it's familiar to, at least my families and communities where I've grown up, old friends and stuff, they're all on the liberal mainstream camp generally. And it's been interesting to see the reaction play out. I am concerned about the level of like violent anger that seems to be present around. So I'm glad to hear these kind of tips for trying to avoid that part of the boil over. In terms of de-escalation tactics, is that something you could give some examples of? I suppose that simply what we've talked about earlier in terms of saying, I want to have a discussion and I want to connect with you, would be a big de-escalation tactic that would hopefully, you know, ideally lead you into building bridges, not just avoiding violence. But are there any de-escalation tactics while we're on this topic that could help people avoid violence in the streets?
Sure. It's as simple as knowing the motives. Yeah. Once you can know the motives, if you can find out what they are, each individual, that gives them, you know, it gives you a potential bridge to reach out to them. Acknowledge their motives is a potential thing. It's, you know, to acknowledge these abstract qualities. Like, I hear you. Are you wanting more safety and security? Mm-hmm. Is that what you want? You know, like, and like I say, it's a specific individual case-by-case situation. Each individual can be reached. It's very challenging to reach out to a crowd. Mm-hmm. It's very challenging to reach out to a humongous demographic. They're abstract completely.
Yeah, yeah.
There will always be a bunch of people who can, I would say, assume the worst. Mm-hmm. You know, they could make a hasty generalization right away by just looking at you.
Yeah, yeah.
White, male, privileged, you know, like that type of thing, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, but some of my ancestors come from Russia. I consider myself an Asian man, you know, and I can say that, you know, it's like, so, you know, please, not so hasty, right? I mean, it comes down to a specific bridge to a specific person is easier, but the whole mob mentality kind of thing, yeah. That's a challenge that can actually be dangerous because it's going to take specific key connection moments mm-hmm. to the people who have the most power in that group, identifying them, find out their motives and connect with those people, the mm-hmm. people who actually have the most power in whatever little mob group or cluster is going on.
Interesting.
That's a challenge.
Yeah.
That's a real precise art. Mm-hmm. Identifying first the people, which ones, and then quickly, what are their motives? If their motives are to instigate hurt and damage towards you, like they are an agent provocateur, mm-hmm. that is their job. Mm-hmm. Sorry, they're a soldier.
Yeah.
So there really is not much to do with that.
Yeah.
That's a combat situation that requires combat tactics.
Yeah.
Okay, nothing you can be done if they're like dead set against you. But most people, as far as I know, are not paid to go against me or you guys or anyone. They're just reaching for those qualities through the strategies that they're used to using.
Yeah.
That's it. And identifying those qualities gives you an edge. Mm-hmm. But if you do not balance your internal terrain first, you're at a disadvantage. It's like fighting on the ground and trying to help someone else up. From the position of on the ground, you're not able to help other people up.
Yeah.
You know, from the position of standing solidly, you can offer a hand up. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And the offer is a request, mm-hmm. as long as you make that explicit, like it's not a demand. Mm-hmm. Because some people, they want to stay on the ground. They want to stay in the emotional turmoil of being down. Mm-hmm. And that's their trip. And that's to respect them where and to allow them to be what they are, feel what they're feeling, think what they're thinking, mm-hmm. is another way of building a bridge.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's just like, those are the tactics I can think of off the top of my head. Cool. De-escalation, it really comes down to that. You really, you know, one-on-one, that's a little bit easier.
Yeah, yeah.
And then if you're in that type of, I don't know, lynch mob situation, that's the challenge because now you really have to understand who are the power players in that situation.
Yeah.
You guys have heard of neuro-linguistic programming?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. NBC's evil twin, as it's been called. So, it's not evil. It's just, I would say, highly effective 10% and 90% marketing. Okay. Mm. I'm going to be studying this more and more over time, but for those who do not use these methods that I'm describing of internal balancing and then interpersonal connection and understanding, you know, what I'm doing makes those tools basically, you know, ineffective on me. Mm-hmm. But for the vast majority of people, those tools of doing body mimicry and certain types of repetition and certain types of word placement and homonym use, you know, very powerful. Yeah. Very powerful in certain, I would say, de-escalation self-defense tactics.
I see.
So if you wanted to look into that, I'd advise like understanding it. There's an article by Scott Adams, the inventor of Dilbert, who wrote this about a year ago. It's called Wizard Wars. You could look it up, Scott Adams, Wizard Wars. Cool. And what his claim was, as someone who practices NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, is that this world has been sewn up for more than 100 years by wizards who use hypnotic methods such as NLP. Mm-hmm. And the present day Grandmaster Wizard is Tony Robbins, according to Scott Adams. Okay. Is that he was on speed dial and is on speed dial for Bill Clinton for a reason. Okay. That there would be reasons for that type of thing, that these people are really out there engaging in perception management, saying many, many words of minimal substance.
Yeah. Yeah.
But maximum emotional gain. Mm-hmm. And that is power right there. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is that you could look at that, look up Wizard Wars, Scott Adams, and mm-hmm. you could understand something. He predicted the Trump win a year ago, and that's what I used. I could have made some money on this one. Wow. But that's what I used for my own prediction, saying, I think Scott's right this time, mm-hmm. you know, that it's all sewn up, mm-hmm. that this is Donald Trump is a user of these methods, and that all of his campaign shows applications of these methods. Lots of words, minimal substance, mm-hmm. flamboyant, perception management to the T, you know. And I look at this very seriously. So I like to say, you know, put it out there. Mm-hmm. Study the methods that could potentially be used against you. All of what I just described could be used against us, mm-hmm. but with knowledge of it, less so. Just like Kung Fu, you know, it's the same. I'd like to, you know, use that as a metaphor. These are Kung Fu of the mind and Kung Fu of the heart. The Trivium method is the mind method. The NVC, as I use it, is a heart method. Together, they create a powerful tool. And then using what David Allen made for getting things done, something I advise the viewers to look up getting things done, you'll see that that's an organizational and action-based method. Put the three together is my suggestion. Mm-hmm. And also look into neuro-linguistic programming. Look into the history of it. Look into Ericksonian hypnosis mm-hmm. of more than a century ago. Mm-hmm. And understand that I would say here's an exploration. Here's my assignment for all the viewers out there. Make a list of all the areas in your life where you had a strong conclusion and new evidence came in and you realized that you were incorrect in that conclusion. Make a list of all the things that you were, to one extent or another, fooled into believing. Mm-hmm. Make a list of that and review that list. And then look at the conclusions that you presently hold. How many of those ones could be erroneous in a similar way? How many of those ones are you possibly being fooled with? Mm-hmm. I mean, there are all these contentious issues I could bring up with you guys, like abortion and pornography and all kinds of things. And I could find out, what are your conclusions now? And where did you learn that? Mm-hmm. And what degree are you flexible on that? What degree are you curious to learn more? Mm-hmm. How much humility do you possess in the exploration of that topic? Mm-hmm. I invite the viewers to consider these words. Oh, and that's your assignment.
Nice. Anything you want to
mention? Oh my gosh. Wow. See you next month for round two.
Yeah. This could be a regular thing.
Yeah. And I would love to continually check in and kind of see how we put these into practice, because that's, if these are the methods used against us, and I think most of us, if not all of us listening, understand that this is in play and this stuff works within our politics, then it's very important to understand where it's coming from. And then simultaneously to understand that if these things are in play, then I can't look at every single Trump supporter and just think that that's how they are and that's who they are. I need to understand that there are all these other multiple, you know, things interacting with them and their perception at the same time, and just keep that in mind as I try to move forward and encourage my peers to hopefully do the same, because trying to move forward without respect and compassion is not going to work. And I don't know how that looks right now with whoever's in charge being who they are, but I don't see any other logical path other than trying to come at it from this angle. There's just not. So here we go. It's
going to
be a busy year.
Yeah, I look forward to checking in next month. I'll share my list with everyone. You can share your list about, you know, what things. Like, I concluded these things. I, through one thing or another, being in certain relationships with people, mm-hmm. They had certain firm conclusions. This is very frequent. And then for acceptance purposes and respect and trust purposes, I adopted the same conclusions. I came upon new evidence, tried to bring up the evidence, found the pushback kind of thing. But still, for me, evidence prevails, you know, at a certain point, because I like a predicted and desired result and not a chaotic and unpredictable result that gives me undesirable results. Mm-hmm. You know, I like things to be predictable and desirable and not chaotic and like tragic, you know?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, you know, for the rest of the viewers here in the YouTube comments, you can post all the things that you personally concluded and then have changed your mind on, unless, of course, Morgan chooses to make comments not available.
No, we'll leave comments on.
We're gonna leave comments on. All right, that's risky.
Sure. I don't get much traffic, so it's safe.
Word, I know the feeling. Right on. So, that's what I have on my list so far. Did we cover everything? Let's see.
I think we covered most of the things that I wanted to talk about in general today. I feel really good about it. I did. There's one other thought that's kind of a side note, and it's very much in the, you know, within the stage and the narrative and the illusions. But but I have this feeling that in the process of Donald Trump's next chapter, as you know, now his character in the narrative is the presidential version of Donald Trump, the personality that he is. You know, he's going through some transition as we speak behind doors, it seems. And I'm basically, one of the things I've tried to do over the last 5 years as I look at very dark aspects of deep politics and our reality is if I'm giving much mind to the worst case scenarios, I also want to do a little visualization of the best case scenario, at least just to like show me like, you know, to start looking for a path to get there possibly. And so I had one silly thought where, what if Donald Trump is confronted with some strategic reality that he needs to be more unifying on the race issue than he has been? And basically, what if he gave a more perfect union speech like Obama did that could actually reach people who were actually racist and like intentionally, knowingly racist? This was one concept that I've been playing around with. You know, Barack Obama's more perfect union speech around the time of his election was still to this day like my favorite thing he's done as president. Something I think he did for the discussion of the country that was important and helped a lot of people identify their own feelings and concerns and hear them, you know, gave them a sense of shared reality. And I think he was able to reach a lot of people on a lot of sides of different, you know, traditional aisles. But I feel like there's some potential learning moment for the country as we look the Trump supporters in the eye and realize that they've won, and it's something we have to acknowledge that there's a subset of them that have these views, and how do we move forward? So I don't know if that thought experiment's at all interesting to you. I would love to see a Trump more perfect union speech in response to this moment in time.
Whatever is chosen to be done is going to be an interesting thing right there. Like, I have no idea what these people will choose to do. Mm-hmm. I just don't know. But I would say this, the name of the game to me is perception management.
Yeah. Yeah.
The name of that whole thing. So I'm going to look up the more perfect union speech by Obama later.
Yeah.
Since I'm not familiar with it, because I've chosen to try to spend my time carefully, and that does mm-hmm. not include an in-depth study of what Barack Obama said.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, just like it's similar to you know, looking up whatever Jack Black said or whatever Larry King said. You know, it's they're public figures and they might say some interesting things, but in the case of Obama, I strongly suspect perception management mm-hmm. of me when I'm watching it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And whenever that happens, I'm very cautious to understand what are the impacts emotionally and intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
The hasty generalization, just to know that in that informal logical fallacy,
mm-hmm.
is to remove racism or mm-hmm. any ism.
Mm-hmm.
Because now you're seeing people as individuals and you're understanding that perception, if you're looking at it as a group, is flawed. As individuals, is real.
Mm-hmm.
So it comes down to something like that. I'm looking to sort of install, if possible, or to offer an update.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to people's operating systems, both mentally and emotionally. And the mental one is really important. It's critical because it's taking in data, grammar, as we call it, and it's seeing the connections between the grammar. That's logic. And that also means isolating components that are hypocritical, irrational, or contradictory. Those are the informal logical fallacies. And then from there, it's seeing the practical applications of the first two. It's actually putting it into play or seeing it in play or seeing examples of it into play. When you have those components moving like that, that's exciting because then you have movement and there is no need to call someone a racist or think of them as a racist. Instead, they're a person who's engaging in an informal logical fallacy as something that they learn to do. And when I engage with that, now they're just a person making decisions. I could see them as a human. I remove the label racist from them. They're a person. They use fallacies as their decision-making process. That's what they learn to do.
Yeah.
I learn to identify such, and if possible, I try to teach folks who want to learn how to do that. So it's like basically a virus scanner for your mind, a firewall.
Mm-hmm.
It prevents corrupted information from coming in and also stops it from going out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it goes both ways. And whenever you have a bug in the system, like when I was angry at the people up the hill, that was a sign that because I was so concerned about the effects on their child, and there's been many concerns I've had about how they raised their child, honestly, that was me being out of balance.
Mm-hmm.
That was an inside job for Darrell to take care of. So I think that that's basically where I wish to start it. You know, like I'm going to look up his speech. I'm kind of curious like that. Putting out like, you know, misinformation is out there. It'd be like real useful information that's like verified in, you know, facts and such in a sandwich of lies. like that. So whenever there's something like that, and by the way, Barack Obama, heavy proponent use of NLP. In his speeches, whether he was trained in it on his own or he's just delivering it, you know, other NLP powerful people crafted the words, is a little less relevant to me. When I'm taking that stuff in, it's like that. But hey, you go to the Lee Camp show sometimes? You get to see the productions?
Most weeks I'm in town, I giggle in the audience instead of my basement.
Right on. Yeah, so this is the kind of thing I'd be really excited to connect with him about that, or like to see if you could connect with him about that, because perception management and to understand any of the components we covered, any of them, much less all of them, but, you know, just even a few, since most people will, you know, burn out from too much Darrell Becker lecture time. It's just like even some of them can be really exciting. Just like, hey, what do you think of this shiny new tool? You know, it's like the Prius of your mind, or the Uber of your heart, you know, that kind of thing. it's like that, you know. I'm looking for, boy, that sounded really self-promoting.
Peer-to-peer heart sharing.
Yeah, peer-to-peer heart sharing. I'm really looking, like I said, there's a reason I gave those adjectives. I want to make this like widely spread and actually sexy and appealing.
Yeah.
Because I see that now what's sexy and appealing is people dividing themselves between others, dividing themselves even inside of themselves, hurting themselves, giving themselves labels, lazy, ineffective, that type of thing, failure, that type of label. I would say this much. If you see a person, this is one thing I want to leave you with a little bit, is if you see any people who are hurting themselves with such labels, you can see the effect of this. It is the number one thing. one of the most, and you see someone else ganging up on them with them.
Yeah.
That is a very dangerous person. That is a dangerous situation because they are now compromised. They're attacking themselves and they're being attacked from without. Mm. Like, look to see if you can offer to support them. That type of the masochism of them hurting themselves and the sadism of the person getting off on hurting someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And I see this in the Liberty community of people who literally really wish for pain and misery to all of the various so-called liberal people and Clinton supporters, you know, wishing for their pain and their discomfort, liberal tears and that type of thing. This is the lack of empathy, what Wilhelm Reich called the emotional plague. If you look up Wilhelm Reich and what he did in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, this is important. So, you know, I just like to isolate that there's a way of building a bridge of compassion and empathy and connection. Mm-hmm. And the purpose of that bridge is to be more effective, you know, but it starts internally inside since we're, you know, not the Borg.
Yeah. A lot of people don't seem to understand that the sort of logic of working with your heart involved as well is not just emotional or wishy-washy. It's strategically advantageous. You know, it's also rational. It's not an either or, rational or emotional. They collaborate.
Yep. Yeah. It goes back and forth, like the O and the F and the O and the F.
Yeah.
The observations and thoughts inspire the feelings. The feelings are noticed, at least subconsciously, inspire more thoughts, mm-hmm. which inspire more feelings. They're trapped in a little, like, kind of infinity loop like that, you know. And what are they going to do? Here's the other things they're going to do. And I learned this from Julia Turyanskaya. They're going to go to distraction. At the end of the day, they're going to self-medicate.
Yeah.
They're going to change their perception.
Yeah.
This is really sad and uncomfortable. They're going to do what they need to do, drink alcohol, smoke weed. Mm-hmm. And if they're on the thinking that they're purer than everyone else, I would say they're going to engage in their yoga practice in a very, very profound way. They're going to engage in their meditation practice in a profound way. Mm-hmm. Their, you know, whatever their exercise regimen is, they're going to change their perception by distracting.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's a healthy approach of any mammal. Any animal to do when in pain is to definitely find the place that is soothing and helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're going to go into docility, which is the other part of self-medication, you know, to go into, you know, watching a whole lot of Star Trek while, you know, going into whatever type of distraction possibilities, you know. It's like looking over at Morgan.
It's like Civilization for 2 years.
Yeah, we spent a long time playing Civilization. It's one of my favorite games over the years. And,
like
it was
that.
Fun
they're
playing
together. Distraction.
It was, yeah, it was a little unwinding session for us. It was felt
of course.
Therapeutic.
Yeah, distraction and docility. And to honor that space within people instead of condemning it.
Yeah.
You know, like right now you see me facing these things. I'm facing them. I feel the feelings as I describe them. Mm-hmm. And I think the thoughts as I have them go through me. And I come back to some degree of balance because I've been gaining more tools over this last year, like over this last 2 years, especially more and more tools. That's why you're hearing me display things like this stuff. There's an opportunity in this to really find a greater level of functional compassion internally, and then once, like, just like when you're standing, now you have a chance of giving someone a hand up. But if you're down on the ground, you're not going to help easily raise someone else up. Mm-hmm. It's like putting the empathy mask on as the oxygen thing, as the empathy mask drops down on your imaginary plane, you put it on first, help someone else with their mask second, like that, you know.
Awesome.
Criticism of Marshall Rosenberg's book, where self-empathy is chapter 9. I can tell you it will not be that far into my book. Yeah. Yeah. Well, what can I expect? He's an old guy.
Well, is there anything else you'd like to bring up? Do you want to tell people about your website and your upcoming book, The Language of Choice, you just mentioned? Did I get the name right?
The My portfolio website is voluntaryvisions.com. All of my various appearances, including this one, will be posted right there, or right here, because that's where you are watching it. Wow, I'm there, but I'm not there. But I will be there. So there's
sorcery.
There's darrellbecker.com, which is going to have a splash page soon, and I'll be having links to all of anything related to my work right there, as I'm going to be continuing to brand myself with that one. That's like an upcoming project to make. And I would certainly say, yeah, please, if you're interested in all of these elements that I've described in this video, please consider pre-buying my book, The Language of Choice, Voluntary Communication for a Voluntary World. I'm looking to put it all out there in that format of like a serious compendium of methodology to truly open up possibilities like this, to really like essentially create internal connection and their interpersonal connection. And that's my pitch.
Wonderful. Thank you.
And how about pitch your site, since this is you, you know?
Yeah. Well, Katie, do you want to mention anything else and point people any people anywhere?
Well, I suppose if you're in the cannabis industry and you're interested about sustainability, you can find me at gogreenbee.org. And that's about all I've got for that. Oh, also Students for Sensible Drug Policy, of course. If you are not involved or you know students in your life, they might be involved. If not, they should be. You can find us at schoolsnotprisons.org. And I think that's all my pitches.
And you may start blogging about more diverse topics in the future, but it's undecided as of yet.
Also finishing grad school, so we'll get there.
And I've been Morgan Lesko, and my project or umbrella of me trying to figure out how to help the world has been called Wiki World Order for the last 5-6 years, I guess. And I've been making a lot of media in the last couple of years, but this is a fun collaboration opportunity, other than the random animated GIFs I've been making recently, which has been the majority of my Wiki World Order work, aside from just introducing information to my circles that they're not otherwise getting. And I've also been working on an open police complaints website where people will be able to report issues with their local police department. It would go both online and be hopefully formally submitted to the department for accountability on various levels. And then don'tfallacyme.com. Don't Fallacy Me is a game that I made a couple years ago. And it's a great tool. It's ideally supposed to be fun, and it's a collaborative game. So anybody can add their own sort of flashcards, examples of logical fallacies to add to the pile. And you can train your brain to better identify logical fallacies. One of the big things Darrell was talking about earlier during the step of logic of interpreting the information you've gathered is to identify, to run the bullshit test. And it's really nice if you can, you know, with the wine expert?
Sommelier.
Yeah, if you can be a sommelier of bullshit and be able to label it, you know, it has a hint of hasty generalization and...
with just a tang of the appeal to authority to it. Yeah, just like that.
Oh, that tang. So that's another research. And I will definitely be including in the show notes for this video / audio production a link to one of your recent podcast interviews where you describe your techniques that you've been developing in more detail in the order you're used to presenting them and you find most effective, as opposed to this, which was very, thank you very much for hopping around and introducing those concepts, explaining bits of them, at least surface layer, as we went through this case study of this topic. So thank you very much for adapting to the the conversation so elegantly and eloquently as ever.
Thank you so much, Morgan. Thank you, Katie. It was great to meet you. It was awesome to hang with you guys.
Yeah, this is fun. We should do it again.
Yeah, I'm hoping. I would love to meet again next month, and that would be great. I could prepare new things, and you can too. And
cool.
Send me the show notes. I'll add to it, and we'll go from there.
Fun.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Darrell. I hope you have a great next of the day, and this moment treats you well as we enter the next.
Thank you, guys. All right. Take care, guys.
Much love.
Bye.
Bye.
Love you guys. Bye.